Hello! Welcome to my show, Imperfect Murders. I'm your host, Miss Doe. For those who don't know about me, I don't have a name. I'm just Jane Doe. I'm here to remember people. I'm here to tell their stories because someone needs to do it for them. So basically, I'm giving voices to those who no longer have theirs. I'm here to speak for them. On today's episode, we will be the voice of April Johns. On October the 1st, 2012, 5-year-old April Johns disappeared from Machynlleth in Wales. A small market town, Machynlleth was quiet, with a population of only around 2,300 people. April had spent the day at school before going swimming. After swimming, she had spaghetti on toast for tea and then went out to play with friends. Despite having cerebral palsy, April lived an active, happy life. She was bubbly and outgoing, headstrong, and someone who really ruled the roost at home. Just before 7 p.m., her mom reluctantly let her go out to play. April took her bike and met up with a friend to play near her home on the Bryn Y. Gough estate. Moments later, April's friend says that she saw April climbing into a light-colored van. April was never seen again. Around 20 minutes later, April's brother went out to collect her, and moments later returned out of breath to the family home reporting that April was missing and she had gone off in a car. April's mom, Carol, jumped into action, calling police straight away before going out into the estate to look for her daughter. The police arrived quickly and got straight to work. April's image was circulated to the press, and news outlets quickly picked it up. April's disappearance was the first use of a nationwide child rescue alert in the UK. Roadblocks were established to prevent cars coming in and out of the town, and police were searching vehicles, but it was already too late. April was gone. Hundreds of locals came out to help with the search, moving quickly and covering an area in excess of 30 miles using quad bikes and off-road vehicles. The police quickly established that April had got in the car willingly, using the witness statement of her friend. As was typical of an investigation of this kind, police focused their efforts on known pedophiles in the area. But that same evening, they arrested a 46-year-old man, confirming that although he was being questioned, they had not found April and were continuing to search for her. The Guardian reported that the man was picked up on foot walking outside of the town on the A487 and that he owned a vehicle similar to the one described, which had been seized and was being examined. Following his arrest, a 12-mile stretch of that road was closed off by police. The following day, on October the 3rd, police named the man in custody as local man Mark Leonard Bridger, who was described as living close to April's home. It was an unusual move from the police, releasing his name and photo, along with a picture of his vehicle and license plate. Generally, in the UK, identities are held back until a suspect is charged. The police needed to know Bridger's movements between 5 p.m. on Monday evening until his arrest at 3:30 p.m. on Tuesday. Despite continuing to search, including using mountain rescue teams, dog handlers, and performing water searches, there was still no trace of April. Well, who is this Mark Bridger? Mark Bridger was born in Sutton, South London in 1965 and moved to Machynlleth in the 1980s before getting married in 1990. At the time of April's disappearance, he had three children, including an older son and two daughters, aged 7 and 10, who lived just yards from April's home and they are believed to have all played together at times. Bridger was also known to the Johns family. April's dad first met him in 1992 when a 30-something Bridger was dating the 15-year-old sister of Mr. Jones' then-girlfriend. This wasn't the first time Bridger had been in contact with the police either. He was put on probation at age 19 after being caught with a firearm and in 2004 had been convicted of threatening a police officer with a machete following a row with an ex-partner. In 2007, he was also given a suspended jail sentence for punching a man. On Thursday, October the 4th, police held another press conference and remained strong in their approach to searching for the missing girl. They didn't give much away in terms of the investigation, but stated there wasn't anything to connect another subject or vehicle to the disappearance and that a vast amount of forensic analysis was taking place at the time. It seems that they believed they had their man, although any trace of little April was still yet to be found. Thursday afternoon, police officers began to focus their search on a whitewashed cottage, a burnt-out building 5 miles from where April went missing. The property was lived in by Bridger. The search was thorough, with manhole covers and concrete slabs raised in and a fourth to find April. It was clear to those watching on that the investigation had entered a more somber phase. Cadaver dogs were deployed and water around the area was checked. In Channel 5 documentary April Jones interrogation tapes, we learned that while in custody, Bridger asked for a map, poring over it for hours in the hopes that he might help police figure out where April was. It was fruitless, however, and forensic psychologist Dr. Joe Sullivan believed it to be a ruse to allow him time alone to figure out what questions he would be asked and prepare his answers. On Friday the 5th of October, police announced that they no longer believed April to be alive. A murder inquiry was launched and detectives had until Saturday afternoon to charge or release Mark Bridger. The following day, police did indeed charge Mark Bridger with the murder of April Jones, but they still had not found her body or any trace of her. In custody, Mark had admitted that he took April, but that he could not remember what had happened to her. His memory, it seemed, had failed to recall the most important parts of that evening. Appearing in court on the Monday, the 8th of October, Bridger was bombarded with abuse from members of the public as they benched on the passing policeman, yelling at him as he was driving inside. He was charged with murder, abduction, and unlawful disposal and concealment of a body. The case was adjourned until the 11th of January the following year. Searches continued for April's body throughout the rest of that year, but soon the new year came around and Bridger was back in court once more, where he entered a not guilty plea to the murder of April, although it was stated that he conceded he was probably responsible for her death. A trial date was set for the 25th of February 2013. However, it was postponed until Monday, the 29th of April. Searches continued for April, but a week before Bridger was due to stand trial, the search for her remains was called off. The trial began on April the 29th, and a number of things were brought out about Bridger's life and the days leading up to April's murder. On the day of her abduction, Bridger had broken up with his girlfriend, and he didn't go to work. Instead, he stayed at home, watching cartoons online of young girls being abused. He contacted several women and asked them out on dates before attending his daughter's parents' evening meetings at around 5:30 p.m. At 7:15 p.m., he was seen near the garages where April went missing, before being seen again moments later driving away quickly. The next morning, around 9 a.m., Bridger was seen carrying a black bin bag while walking along a small road near the river. When questioned about this, he said he had a V and that if April's DNA was found on his penis, it would be because of this V. This, for obvious reasons, was an incredibly suspicious thing to say to the police. At 10:30 that same morning, he was seen walking his dog 3 miles from the town. He was caught on footage from the police helicopter. Smoke can be seen coming from the chimney of his house. At 3 p.m. that day, the police arrived at his house looking for April, and they noted that the cottage was hot and smelled strongly of detergent, and this made them immediately suspicious. He was arrested 30 minutes later near the river and immediately said that he already knew what it was about. In custody, Bridger told police that he accidentally hit April with his car, appearing to almost cry as he describes crushing her little body before taking her inside the car and laying her on the passenger seat to seek help. But then he had simply forgotten what happened afterwards. He said he drove around looking for medical help, but that he didn't call the police or an ambulance. Instead, he drove out of the state using a local quiet back road. He said that drink and panic had caused his memory loss. Bridger told police in his interview that he wished he could remember what he did so that she could be laid to rest. However, when he later took to the stand in court, his story changed and said that he now remembered laying April down in the front room before his next recollection was waking up between 3 a.m. and 5 a.m. the next morning. When he searched for his house and car for the little girl, who he could not find her. The police found images of child abuse on Bridger's computer, and on the day of April's abduction, he viewed a cartoon of a child being raped while restrained. When challenged about this in his interview, Bridger's upset and crying exterior broke, with him becoming angry, defensive, and argumentative with police. His excuse was that he had stored the images because he planned to make a complaint about them. The police also found images of local girls, including April, on his computer. He had also searched repeatedly for the Soham murders, a recent case of two children murdered in the UK. Despite not finding a body, a narrative of what police believed happened began to emerge when the forensic evidence was analyzed. There was no evidence that Bridger's car had been in an accident. No tissues, fibers, blood, or any other material was found on the front or underneath of his car. This would have been impossible if he had, in fact, run over April with his car. Furthermore, no evidence of April was found on the inside of the car either. When police searched his house, they found traces of April's blood in the living room, hall, and bathroom. Bridger tried to explain specks in the bathroom as possibly coming off his hands as he flicked them dry after washing them. This reason was given after having just told police that he could not see any visible blood on April and provided a contradictory statement. When asked if he assaulted April in the bathroom, he was vague and said, "Not that I recollect." A concentration of blood was found in front of the wood burner in the living room underneath the carpet and on the hearth. The blood on the underside of the carpet was large and suggested that the visible blood on the top of the carpet had been cleaned away. More specks of blood were found on the shower curtain and on the washing machine. There was also a trail of blood leading from the living room door to the center of the room. Within the fire, a number of burnt bone fragments were found, but it was too difficult to ID these. Although believed to be the bones of April Jones, this could not be definitely proven. DNA which they did find, however, proved damning for Bridger, as April's DNA was found in a sample taken from the crotch of his tracksuit trackers that he was wearing when arrested. With all of these evidence and Bridger's partial confession, he was found guilty on the 30th of May and given a whole life tariff, the maximum sentence available in the UK. In September 2013, April's family held a funeral for the little girl, with mourners wearing a splash of pink, April's favorite color. Despite appeals to Bridger, he never revealed where her body was, and all her parents had to bury were the 17 bone fragments discovered in his home. Instead of flowers, her parents asked for donations to a church project which sponsors a 5-year-old girl in Uganda. The sponsorship lasts her childhood and to help her finish education with any remaining money going to the other villagers. In January 2014, Bridger abandoned an appeal against his whole life tariff and remains in prison. In November 2014, the house where Bridger lived and is assumed to have killed April was demolished, and in 2005, a memorial garden was created on the space that the house once stood as family and friends member. April and the friends remember April and the short but precious time she had with them. Knowing that we don't have April's body makes me so sad, but at least we kind of know what happened to her. We know that she is dead, so we don't have to wait for her to come back one day. I feel like Imperfect Murders are better than Middle of the Fog, because as you know, Middle of the Fog series is about the cases we have almost zero information about, and I don't know what to say, but I don't know what you think about it, but why would someone make cartoons about a little girl being raped? Why would someone make it? I can't understand it. Like, what is the reason? Those people are psychos, and why do we let them do it? I'm so angry. I don't care if that's their fetish or not. Like, I don't judge anyone, but pedophiles are bad. Like, what the fuck? Bad is a pure word for pedophiles. They're not bad. They're mean. They're psychos. I can't find the words. Okay, I guess that's all. I'm so angry that I can't even speak. I can't speak in normal times either, so don't mind me. I'm not native. Thank you for remembering Apple Jones with me. If you liked the video, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel, because it really motivates me, and knowing that people here support my goal is amazing. Someone needs to remember those people, and why won't you be one of them? That's all. Have a life, love stars. Till then.